On February 27th, 1984, Scandinavian Airlines Flight 901 touched down at New York's JFK Airport. Up to this point, the flight had been completely uneventful. But now, the aircraft was hurtling down JFK's Runway 4 at over 200 knots. That's almost four times the speed of a car on a highway. The plane's automatic thrust control system had malfunctioned, leading to a higher than normal approach speed. Incomprehensibly, the pilots did not recognize this and landed a DC-10 regardless while pretty bad weather prevailed. In the end, this lapse in aircraft monitoring ended with the plane overrunning the end of the runway, coming to a stop partially on soft ground, partially in the waters of Thurston Basin beyond the end of runway 4 right. Luckily, nobody died in this accident, but 12 passengers were injured and the aircraft suffered substantial damage. This accident was not the first runway overrun or runway excursion, not by far. And it wouldn't be the last either. Something had to be done. While pilot awareness and preparedness probably are the best weapons against runway excursions, mistakes and freak failures do happen, so the United States FAA and Air Force got together to devise a solution to the problem of runway overruns. But how do you stop a 50, 100, 200 or 300 ton airliner? To stop a fighter jet, arrestor cables are used on aircraft carriers to bring these fast planes to a stop on the very short carrier deck runways. Planes will land on the carrier while dragging a tail hook behind them. This hook will then, hopefully, catch one of three or four steel wires laid out across the deck. Such landings are at the same time very harsh and delicate. Harsh, because fighter pilots usually slam the planes onto the deck in order to land as quickly as possible, and delicate, because the runway is insanely short. Fighter planes usually come in with their engines at about 85% power, just in case they have to abort the landing. If all cables are missed or one snaps after being hooked, the pilot will reapply full power and go around, or bolter as they say in their jargon. There's even a backup solution, the so-called barrier, which is in essence nothing else than a fancy way of catching a fighter jet with a net. Minor spoiler alert, Top Gun 2 illustrates this principle very nicely. But, alas, none of these solutions is viable or applicable to stop a massive airliner, for various reasons. First, passenger aircraft are just not designed to handle the loads involved in a cable arrestor landing. Basically, the structure of the aircraft would most probably break. Another reason why arrestor gear landings are a bad idea is, of course, passenger safety. Let's imagine for a second that it was possible for a big 747 to catch an arrestor cable. Now, think about what kind of seatbelts passengers wear and what would happen if that 747 would come to a complete stop in a split second. Tons of chiropractors would probably rejoice, but in all seriousness, this is just no viable option. No, another means of stopping large airliners had to be engineered. To that end, the FAA initiated an experimental program with the US Naval Air Engineering Center to conduct experiments on soft ground materials. At first, simple materials like gravel and sand were tested. If you've ever ridden a bicycle from a hard surface onto a beach or other sandy ground, you will immediately know how sand can have a very decelerating effect on a moving object. But these simple materials have some properties that make them very unsuitable due to their inherent natures. Sand would be great, but there is a slight problem. Sand absorbs fluids pretty well. If a plane with a fuel leak was to overrun a runway, that would pose a significant threat to passengers, as spilled fuel could quickly soak into the sand below, creating a fire hazard that would be very difficult to control or put out in case of a fire. Gravel shares this problem, as fuel could also seep between the stones. Additionally, gravel that is flung upwards during a violent deceleration of an airliner could actually puncture the wing tanks or significantly damage engines, further exacerbating the fire hazard issue. By 1989, the engineers of the project presented two viable ideas. They used materials that are hard at first glance, but very brittle if a load is applied. One of these materials was a phenolic foam, which you can imagine as a very sturdy version of styrofoam. The other material was cellular concrete, which refers to a sort of concrete that has loads of little air bubbles enclosed in it, giving it the appearance of a sponge. First tests were conducted in the summer of 1990 to test the properties of these two materials, and in 1993, two full-scale arrests were performed using a Boeing 727 the FAA provided. Engineers were happy with the test results as they found that both materials proved to be excellent. In the year that followed, New York's JFK Airport installed a prototype arrestor bed at the end of runway 4 right. This bed was constructed of various light gray precast cellular cement blocks. And thus, EMAS was born. EMAS stands for Engineered Materials Arresting System. Today, it is widely used in the US and starting to become more and more popular in other areas around the world. Now, you might think, huh, what a simple solution. Pour a bit of porous concrete at the end of the runway and call it a day. That's one way of thinking about it, but in reality, these materials are, as the name says, really accurately engineered. Think about it. These concrete blocks have to be brittle, but also durable. They have to endure searing heat during the summer months, as well as rain, ice and snow during the winter. Also, they sit at runway ends, which means that sometimes they will be situated just behind airplanes taking off if the opposite runway direction is used. Therefore, these blocks also have to endure and withstand jet blasts of the largest and most powerful aircraft engines in the world. And last but not least, the material has to be non-toxic and fireproof so that it doesn't create a hazard to passengers should an evacuation onto an EMAS surface be necessary. Oh, and did I mention that it must be able to hold the weight of a fire truck without crumbling? It would be very bad if a plane came to a stop on an EMAS surface just to burn up there because the firefighters can't reach it. You see, EMAS really lives up to its name. It really is carefully engineered. The invention of EMAS has brought about a large gain in potential safety for many airports. Since it is so effective, it enabled airports that are constructed in tight areas to still offer a safety measure in case of a runway overrun. Usually, runways have to be constructed in a way that leaves a runway end safety area of at least 305 meters or 1000 feet. This area should be flat and featureless. In essence, it should be nothing more than a lawn. But many airports that were constructed in earlier years are unable to offer such luxury. Take for example Sao Paulo's Congonhas Airport. It is constructed in the middle of the city and surrounded by roads and buildings. In 2007, the deadliest crash involving an Airbus A320 happened there, precisely because the aircraft could not stop within the distance of the runway. If you're interested in that, I have a video on that case popping up in the top right corner. Notably, Congonhas Airport fails to offer a proper runway and safety area. Had an EMAS system been installed there, this accident could maybe have been avoided. A question remains though, does EMAS really work? The answer to that is yes, indeed it does. At the runway end of New York JFK's runway 4 right, the EMAS bed has mitigated 3 overruns during which the aircraft involved have been undamaged and their passengers unharmed. As of December 2020, there have been 15 incidents at US airports where EMAS has stopped overrunning aircraft. There were a total of 406 passengers and crew on those incident flights. None of them were harmed. So, you see, this simple yet effective system probably saved countless lives and planes over the past few years. Now, let me know what you think about it. Have you ever heard of this before? Or have you even seen it somewhere at a runway near you? Let me know in the comments down below. Also, if you liked the video, make sure to leave a like and subscribe to the channel. I'll be posting many more of these in-depth look at aviation topics, and you'll find tons of reports on aircraft accidents on my channel. That said, thank you so much for watching, and see you all in the next one. The other material was cellular This bed was constructed of various light gray precast cellular cement blocks. Now say that very fast 3 times.